morning, good afternoon, and good evening to all our viewers out there in this beautiful, beautiful paradise that we all live in. And welcome to another series of intimate conversations with host Janine Savillant and myself, Mandy. And today's guest we have here, which I'm really excited about, is the beautiful Sharon Martin, who is a messenger for Gaia. And welcome, Sharon, and thank you so much for coming along again, because we love having you back and catching up with Gaia and her messages. So thank you for coming in. I'm so excited and I can't wait to hear what you have in store for us. So I will hand it over to Janine to introduce you.
Lovely to have you back again, Sharon. I'm looking forward to this time together as well. Okay, so Sharon is a conduit and messenger for Gaia. She brings through information from Gaia on what is to come for humanity and the Earth. You can access more information about Sharon and her work by visiting her website at www.sharonmartin.com. And from there, you can navigate to her Facebook page and YouTube channel. Also, you're able to find information on the website about her personal readings and sessions. So just a very short bio today, because I'm sure most of the viewers already know Sharon very well. And for those that don't, you're about to get to know Sharon over the next hour. So Sharon, let's start today with you sharing with us your view on the current energies and their effect on humanity at this time.
Yes, well, good morning to the two of you, and thank you so much for inviting me. It's a pleasure to come and spend time with you. And it's, you know, it really feels more and more like my work to be able to tell people the information that I get. And so it's always a blessing to be able to do that in another place, on another platform. So right now we are in this space and have been since the beginning of this month, where there's this absolute increase in energies on a daily level. So every day they get faster, the frequency either increases or changes. It's more expansive. So we've also been going through higher purification, and it's really, in a way, it is as though our bodies are being prepared for ascension energies. And so we've had some waves of those energies come through. Mm. And Gaia speaks about, uses the word tempering, that they are tempering our body so that we can receive them. And so in this cycle of receiving the energies and then integrating them, we're going through purification as well. So it's this process of the energies come in, we have to be not necessarily deliberate, but a little bit intentional in receiving them. We have to acknowledge that we're receiving these energies, and we, you know, just allow them to do their purification through the cells. And then as it's doing that, it's also catalyzing the remembering, the reconnection, the smoothings of our DNA stranding. So we're reconnecting back to 12 strands of DNA so we can come into more of our fifth dimensional and above skills and talents and gifts. So that's the process that we're continually in. And over the last few years, we've been doing that, you know, maybe every few weeks we get something. And it started off with, you know, every few months we would get something, but now we're getting this every day. So sleep is your integration time. And it's very, I would say it's the most important thing for each of us to do, is to be mindful of these energies coming in, to transform, transmute, transmigrate, transfigurate our bodies. And so you have to be tuning into self to see what you need. And for most people, that will be such things as needing to be more hydrated, probably needing more sleep, maybe at odd times of the day, and getting into nature. If we do those three things, then that will help our bodies to hold these higher frequencies. So on the second, we had a big wave come through. So it was shown to me as this kind of increasing wave that would happen through this month, but then we'd have these pillars come down. So that's what we're in the midst of at this moment, is this huge pillar of information or codes. And how it's been shown to me is, so we're on the 21st today. So tomorrow, on the 22nd, Gaia has shown me that we will have a wave, and she calls it a wash. It's like it has a wash effect, and it's washing away anything that isn't truth. People's masks, all of the things that we've told ourselves that aren't true, all of the things that we've been told that aren't true, they're all going to be washed away, like all of the curtains that have been, you know, placed over us in their various forms, either through self or through society or through a whole lot of the sort of infiltration things that have been going on in our world in terms of frequencies and waves and information that comes across mainstream films, things like that. So it's as though tomorrow this is all going to be sort of washed away. So even people who are asleep, what we would say are asleep, they're going to have this kind of movement to awake. It feels like that. It's this wave. It's like a pre-ascension wave. So that's what we're going to be experiencing tomorrow. So I don't know how that's going to feel energetically, to be honest. But I would say that it will be a bit of an up-leveled repeat of however you felt on the second, whatever your experience was of the energies that came in on the second. So that's kind of where we're at. So we're in this huge change in our bodies. And it's also, we can hold this higher light. And it's also, so we can move to higher principles. So right at this moment, what's happening is there's a lot going on in our mind. So a lot of the energies that have been coming in have had a focus, or at least one of the foci within the energy has been on opening up and expanding our pineal gland, which is the gland that connects us to our consciousness. So that's been being affected by things coming in from a variety of places, and I get a bit general about where the energies come from because it doesn't really matter to me, so I don't kind of ask. I get little bits and pieces of it, but that's not my focus. But definitely there's been energies that have come through, for example through the full moon, there were energies that came through, and that was specific to this opening of the pineal gland. And the energies coming through at the moment are that. So it's funny how some of the things I get shown, but I got shown to it like it was like a piece of dehydrated fruit that got soaked in water, and it just went expanded. Yep. So that's the kind of effect that it's having, so that people can begin to access their psychic vision, their psychic dreams, their however that each of us might have that attribute, that gift of seeing. And so that's also affecting our physical eye. So we're going through another round of having physical upgrades. So maybe sore eyes, gritty eyes, times where your vision is really blurry and other times when it's perfect. And so all of this is part of this opening up. And then the other, there's just so much, honestly, it's crazy. The other thing is this shifting off of old ways of being. So what Gaia said, the big lesson for humanity last year was for people to be able to attune to themselves, to tune into their own inner voice, their higher self or their consciousness or their heart or their soul or however you might frame it, but to be able to tune into that and your own authority, your own sovereignty, and get your answers from there. And so it wasn't important what your answer was, it was important that you lined up with what your answer was. So she was saying that this was, you know, coming to your own authentic truth and then being able to speak it, to stand in it, to present it. So the whole thing about whether you decided to go and have one of those injections or not was really about that. In a way, it was you could see it as a test of where you are at. And, you know, so we know there's a whole lot of story around all of that, and I don't think we'll talk about that. But that happening. And so that was the lesson for last year. But this year, the lesson coming for humanity is for us to be able to neutralize the emotions of things. So that's another thing we're going through at the moment. We are learning to come into contact with our sensory body, to shift what comes in through the mind. So this, to me, is one of the aspects of working with the two, is we have twos are very connected to higher consciousness, to things coming from off our earth, new things coming. That's part of their work. They bring new things to the planet. So they bring it in. They're very mental people who are working with the number two. They're very in their heads. And so their work, their learning is to be able to bring it down into the body, into the heart, and feel it through the sensory body to be able to give it out to the world. So in a way, you know, that's what we're all doing this year. So we're learning to be more in our emotional body, more in our sensory body, but remove the aspects of it that interfere with us. So this idea of being able to say, well, you think that, and you think that, and I'm okay with that.
Exactly.
You know, I'm okay. I can sit in this middle part. I can sit
taking the emotion out.
Yeah. Yeah. The zero point, the neutral point, where we can be balancing in the center and be absolutely okay with somebody thinking that and somebody thinking that, and them not really looking as though they could sit by side by side. But that's what we're going to be able to do. So, you know, in a simple way to explain it would be to have, you know, that some people might look at my top and say, well, that's blue, and some people might look at this top and say that that's green. And somebody who's more specific about color, you know, might say it's teal or turquoise, but all of those are correct. Yeah. You know, it's just a perception. Yeah. And so that's a non-emotional belief or construct, but we're going to be able to do that with really big, lofty things by the time we get to the end of the year. And so this brings us more into this unity consciousness. So these are the things we're releasing from our mind at the moment. So these constructs that we've held so tightly that prevent us from being in unity, which has been this infiltration that's been going on in our world. It's been to create separation, to create division, to create little groups that can't form and therefore create an energy of inclusion. So all of those things, we're, you know, watching them move away. And that's, to me, that's the beauty of what we're witnessing in Wellington. There's you know, people coming without a plan. They just needed to be there. They felt drawn to be there from all walks of life and ages and groups. And they have come together and they've found, well, they had common purpose, but they found common ways of operating under that common purpose and doing that in this beautiful way through their heart. Yep. And so this is really, you know, they're doing what the world is doing this year. They are demonstrating it. That's, and so they're laying in a new template, aren't they?
That's right. Mm-hmm. That's the example of the new world. Absolutely, right there. Yeah. And it's happening all around our world at the moment with all the convoys of all the countries. We have these examples of the new world bubbling and blossoming. It's absolutely fabulous.
It's absolutely brilliant. And the other part that comes into that is this coming into balance. So in a way, the men or the masculine have held space whilst the women have come into balance. So, you know, in the long haul of it, we've had, you know, thousands of years where the women were in power and we lost it. You know, we became power mongering, and then it became the masculine's turn and they became power mongers. And we've been doing this back and forth over history. And you know, in this sort of last 100 years, you know, women have gone through their sort of liberation, their freedom, their trying to create, smash the glass ceiling. And now we're really moving into being able to come into our own and not needing to emulate one another. Yeah. And so a lot of the women have come into balance. We're able to be in our feminine and our masculine in this beautiful way. And we did that because the men held space for us. And so now we are to hold space for them because they, it's beautiful the way Gaia described this to me. It's like they come in and they come into their dantian, they come into their power center. That's their role now, to come into their power and go, no. And to be in that role of protecting the women and children of the world. And so this is how they come back into their balance. They have to come into that sort of roar of the lion, to come into that way of being protected or protective. And women, the women of the world, you kind of have to step back. And I mean that in a really loving way, but, you know, and I put my hand up to this, the women of the world, we emasculated the men in our world.
Yes.
Not healthy. So now we have to be, you know, apologizing for that.
That was opening our hearts again to them.
That was the tussle. Yeah. So now we're all coming back into that beautiful balance, and we really can't create our new world without that. So, you know, this is the opportunity also for our men to stand up and to be there as a force to be reckoned with.
To take their place again, because they really did lose their way, as we all did. I mean, we all have in our own way, but we definitely did step the men out and stand up in their place, because we became, it came to a point where we were actually protecting ourselves from them.
Yes.
When their role shifted, you know, and we had to take it all on the woman. Now it's time to share it out again. And like you say, step back. Yeah.
Yes, it's and beautiful. It isn't that we're lesser, it's that we have to recognise that we each hold different roles, we each carry different energies.
Yeah.
So we have our part to play, and it only works when both of those parts are in balance.
And that's right.
Partnership.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. Yeah. What I was going to say, Sharon, it's all about what's inside us as well, and the divine masculine, divine feminine coming into unity and balance within us, and it's represented around us as well in our world.
Yeah. But it's really been, I've just been this little grinning woman, because I have had these men come to me for sessions, and oh my gosh.
Yes.
They are the most exquisite, beautiful men. They're strong. They're in their power, and they're in their hearts. So they just carry this yummy energy.
Totally agree.
More and more that's happening, you know. So that's just all good signals that this is all in sync with what we're talking about.
Absolutely.
It is. It's gorgeous. And I think, you know, just going back to the Wellington thing, you know, and the unity that's happening there, and the template, like you mentioned, the template, I don't know that any other convoy and gathering, in a sense, is set up the way that Wellington's set up. You know, they've got classes in there for the children, they're teaching the children, they've got schools, they've got classes going on for all sorts of people, you know, Tai Chi and meditation and healing. They could put a call out to healers to go down and do healing work and train and teach others. And it's just amazing what's going on there. And the beautiful kohas, you know, the giftings and the gifts that are coming forward that are helping them to survive there. It's just so beautiful.
Yeah,
it's totally the new world.
Yes,
absolutely.
I was speaking to one of my biological sisters yesterday, and I said to her, you know, I can't help but think that the reason that we have been able to do this here is because of the tikanga, the kaupapa of our Māori, because this is how marae work. This is, you know, everyone. You go to the marae, all the women just go in and pick up a potato peeler, basically. You know, once you're in there, and you know, the men go and get a stone or a spade or whatever, and you know, there's this, it's not about roles, it's just that everybody pitches in, and so there's already these sort of systems and mechanisms within Māori that enable all of that to be set up so easily, because, you know,
absolutely
up to play in any of that we'll see that it's a machine. When you go onto a marae where there's hundreds of people and somehow everyone gets fed and bedded and, yes, you know, welcomed. And so I think that's been maybe the reason why that foundation has been able to be easily put in place, because when you think about it, it's quite incredible that in just, what, 2 weeks?
Yeah.
In 2 weeks, that
what they're doing.
It's real. That is really almost a miracle.
Yeah,
it is. Absolutely. It is. It's so beautiful.
Yeah.
And everyone that's gone just doesn't want to leave. Mm. Yeah.
And it's so heartwarming. And so Sharon, if you were to Phelan and with Gaia, and what messages would Gaia have for all those who listen to this for the next, say, 1 to 3 months?
Yes. Let me just see. I wrote lots of notes. The other thing that's happening currently that I haven't spoken about is that our hearts are expanding and we're dissolving old ways around love. So you might have been feeling that earlier this week. There was definitely this focus on the, you know, like the transactional way of being in a love relationship. You know, you do that for me and I'll do that for you. You know, I'll cook dinner if you rub my feet. All of that's all dissolving, so we can come into higher principles of doing things out of unconditional love, doing things because we see that is something loving to do, to give.
Yes.
So this is another thing that we're, that's why it's so, you know,
yummy.
I was thinking yesterday,
yeah,
you know, when I first started doing this work, what would be happening in one day would be, you know, the sort of what I would write would be the equivalent of what was happening over a month. And now it's what's happening in a month is kind of coming in a day.
You know, higher love is service to others. So higher love is all about giving and not so much about service to self and what is in it for us. It's we find what is in it for us when we give to others. That is where we get our gifts ourselves. And so, this is the world we're moving into. It's just beautiful. Higher love. I love that.
Really only happen when you've done your internal work.
Yeah.
Because then your wounding is out of the way. You're not looking for something in return.
Yes, exactly.
So you do your inner work. And then it's just this beautiful gift to others. Yeah, that service.
Yeah, yeah.
That wounded child turns into the holy child, doesn't it? That's that creative, joyful space that I just love.
Yes, yes. And that's a perfect segue to, you know, what's kind of going to be happening more next month's energy is going to be that this coming into this triadic way of being, of where we're recognizing the different aspects of ourselves. So, you know, that child aspect. So, you know, I use different language to you, Mandy, but it's the same. I talk about that the child holds the wounding and the wisdom. And so once we have attended to the wounding of the child, then we have access to the wisdom. And so, you know, we're coming into that sort of that marriage of that as well, that sort of trinity union of that, the masculine, feminine, and the child. So we come into the purity and beauty of our own inner divinity. I just want to read to you what I wrote. Today's an 11 day as well, an 11 universal day. So if you add up 21 plus 2 plus 20, 22, comes to 11.
Tis two.
So this is what I wrote from Gaia for today, for here. We are in major transformation at the moment. Many of you will be experiencing extreme heat in the body and intensity in the heart space, as old templates of love are being released and space is created for new ones to be configured. This will be an ongoing process for humanity in all aspects of life, relating, communicating, and connecting, which is affected by the unified fields and higher principles are re-established on the earth. Because we all know that when we've been here in other lifetimes, that we've operated on these principles. So it's why it's, you know, they are returning. So I did put some of that up on Facebook, but I did write it for here. Let me see. So we're in warm-up ascension waves. A key factor is to learn to be present. So because so much is happening, it can be very overwhelming. And so that's Gaia's advice, is to be in present moment. Mm. If you don't have a wherewithal to do that, I always think the breath is a good way to bring some.
That's what I agree.
Totally. Follow the breath in through the nose and out through the mouth. And all of a sudden there'll be nothing going on in your mind once you've done that a few times. And then especially for the masculine in our world, they're really moving, and the masculine aspects of us, if we're not in balance, we are moving from this focus of being in the head to being in the heart.
Mm. There's so much of that going on. Like, so many of that, you know, I think we've all talked about this at some point, but how the younger generation have this very, that they all live in anxiety, major anxieties. And it stopped them from being social in this world. But for me, I feel that was deliberate in a sense.
I agree.
For them not to actually become part of that world that we're breaking out of now. They weren't meant to. So the anxiety kept them out of it, which is a great thing. But now what I'm seeing with many of them is the struggle now, and they have been having struggle, and it's creating more panic attack now because their minds have just gone really overboard and they're now learning how to come away from the mind and switch it through the body. And it's really interesting. I've been watching it and observing it with many of my daughter's friends, and they're all coming back to a place of heart and now settling. It's like they're really aligning now with their heart self and their true. It's really beautiful. But it's been hard for them, it has been.
Have you seen how they've done that, Mandy?
Just by mainly being aware that what their mind is doing is telling story. And it will create emotional, you know, the emotional triggers the story. But when they realize the story is just a story, it's not actually happening. It's all the what ifs. You know, so it's realizing that they've coming into a place with the story into fear, which triggers the body into the panic, and they're realizing that actually nothing's happened from that. I'm okay. It didn't happen. So I didn't have to go there. And they're realizing, and it's starting to really trigger and switch them over. It's been wonderful watching.
Oh, yeah. That's such good internal wisdom that they're experiencing. Mm. And that's what everyone
is.
I used to annoy my students. Yeah. I would say to them, so how long are you going to tell that story for? No, you don't have to stop it. Yeah. But just make a decision. You know, how long are you going to say that for? You can say it for a day, a month, a year, whatever. You that's your choice.
Yeah.
And they go, and I'd say, well, it's true.
You know? Yeah.
Tell that story.
That's right.
And decide, does it serve you to keep telling it or does it not?
Yeah. And how does that story make you feel is what I say to them. You know, and you can obviously see from the story and them saying it that they're not comfortable and that it's creating all this panic or fear. And I go, well, why go into that story if that's how it makes you feel? You know, so bringing them back to the feeling state, and that they can change that feeling in a moment by just a different thought.
And I think
change the story.
Television creates that.
Absolutely.
It's the energy of drama, isn't it?
Yeah.
You know,
the
energy of drama, and so then they build that into their storytelling, and then they don't understand that in doing that, they're creating the cycle of energy running through their body that is keeping the drama in perpetual motion. And it's just not.
No, it is. And years ago, Spirit showed me how we were going to go into flatline. So we're moving through all the dense emotional stuff. Then we come into a flatline, which, you know, you've moved out of all this. And I was like, and then what? So that's, we die. No. no, then you'll raise into the higher frequencies of joy and love and all the goody stuff, you know. And when we were talking about flatline, I thought, gosh, you know, we've got so much drama in this stuff here. And this is going to be a bit boring. You know, and I said to them, that's going to be really boring because there's going to be no drama in there. It'll just be, you know, beautiful, yummy stuff. And you know, sitting in that space, it is just the most beautiful place to be. And yes, let go the drama. It's like, holy moly, we don't need it at all. We think we do. We think it makes life a bit exciting.
Some people can only identify themselves through the drama in their life. If they didn't have that drama, they wouldn't know who they are. So they create drama so they can get a sense of themselves within that story. When people realise that, when those that do that realise that, that's when they can break that illusion and step through, and the mastery comes in the centeredness and the quietness of self and the stillness of self. No drama. Yeah. Neutral, that neutral place, Sharon, that you spoke of before. Drama-free in that neutral place, because we don't have a judgment. We observe rather than stepping in and judging. So,
It's just something that happened.
Yeah.
It's an interesting stretch, isn't it? I was laughing because I remember a client said to me not very long ago, yeah, but life would be really boring if I got rid of all this drama. What would you do? What do you do? Mm-hmm. And I said, you find internal things that
can be.
You find things that you observe that bring joy. It's just a shift. You just don't need the drama to be fed. You get fed on, I do anyway. You know, I get
peace, serenity, and
the perfume of flowers as I'm walking through the bush.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. That's just what I was thinking, Sharon, as you were speaking. It was like in drama's absence, you can stand in a moment and appreciate so much more that moment is bringing you engage your senses in the perfumes of the moment and the deep connection to the hearing and the feeling of the skin and you know, the beauty that's held in a moment without drama feeds us from the inside out.
Stillness, that observing from that stillness. That's I guess a way to describe it for people who haven't got to have that experience yet is, if you think about being in the middle of the bush in New Zealand anyway, if you think about being in the middle of the bush in New Zealand where there's nothing that you need to be concerned about in terms of your safety, unless you fall off the cliff. And to just close your eyes and to feel that, the stillness. And from that point, you know, like if you go into the bush and you don't talk, you know, you have that experience of hearing nature, of hearing. I went out onto the deck last night because I could hear a sound like a bell and I couldn't fathom it out, and I realized it was two sets of insects and somehow in the connection of the sounds, I don't know what it was. It was a cicada and something else, but there was this sound like this little bell being rung in the midst of it. And if I was in noise, I wouldn't have noticed that, you know. But when you're in
you
go into that stillness and you can hear, you can focus on
the sound. We miss so much of the moment when we are in our dramas or we're lost in our thoughts, but to come present, to bring ourselves present into the moment, that moment holds so much more for us.
Beauty and magic and then the other thing that's happening at the moment that relates to that, which, you know, that brings you into this that I'm about to speak about, is this: we're moving into quantum time. So, you know, the time matrix is pretty much dissolved, which is why now many people will be having experiences of feeling like the day is 40 hours long or 3 minutes long, you know, depending on where you've put your focus and on what it is that you're requiring. Time matches our needs in a way, but it's a new experience. Like, this is the aspect of working with the quantum time. And so that's another thing that we're, you know, there's so much for us that we're learning and remembering. So that's another thing. And there was something else here. Oh yeah, so we're really in this place of witnessing the dysfunctionality of structure and systems. So in a way, you know, we know that they have to collapse and that they will, but for those people who are maybe just beginning to see this, maybe just beginning to awaken, these deficiencies have to be obvious. So then they can see that the system doesn't function well, it doesn't serve humanity. Yeah. And so then they will be okay with it changing, because if, you know, we know that in order for change to happen, resistance has to drop. And so if we try and force people to change something because we see it or because some people see it, that doesn't work for the good of the whole. So now is the time for the collective. And I often feel like that's who I'm writing for. You know, I'm writing for the collective, this big group. But I'm speaking it to people like us because we're the ones who kind of guide that. But that's what I see, is that now, you know, so our government is now being shown up as, you know, not being perhaps so democratic in terms, even just in terms of hearing what people want to have said, and even in terms of perhaps admitting that situations, scenarios, facts, information have changed. And yet the stance of our government hasn't. So that's a very obvious deficit, as far as I'm concerned. And also the other thing that's showing up, of course, is the lack of our media to portray truth. And even worse than that, the ability of our media to hide truth. And so these are, you know, Guy has spoken about these, that government, politics, banking, finance, pharmaceutical, banking finance is kind of at the end of it, pharmaceutical, medical, health, media, then banking, finance and the economy, that those are the things that will collapse first. So the other things that are showing up, right, as not serving us. And so this is what we'll be witnessing over the next probably 3 years. We'll see everything really will change. And so it will just be how well we can cope with the change. And so those systems that don't serve us at all, they'll either collapse or be regenerated, renewed somehow, because we will shift from being a profit-driven society. So that profit margin, that drives everything. And because we know that we're shifting, so wealth is our God-given right and saving is an indication of lack. So that's another kind of principle that we'll move out of. So we'll move out of this need to save and hoard, said the woman who's become a prepper. but I'm really aware, and I have not kept that to myself. I've, you know, Gaia told me that at the beginning of year before last, and I said that to people. Gaia says, get your gardens growing, because we are going to move into shortage. I went to the gym. Well, I don't go to the gym. I went to a gym training session outside this morning, and my trainer said that now there's a grain shortage. And I said, oh, yeah, that's what Gaia said would happen. That there would be grains and fresh produce, that would be the thing that we would have a shortage in first. And so I have you know, I've been growing and freezing stuff and all the rest of it. So these structural and system changes, and this idea that when each of us has this connection to our own divinity, we'll know what to do. We'll be guided to the next step. will be guided to create connections, to form community. That's what many people have done over this time. And we'll come back to our locality. That's how we'll manage. And so it's interesting, isn't it? Because
just the same messages I've been getting. Messages. Yeah.
And it makes sense because this is, you know, collective consciousness.
Yeah.
And we witness that, you know, this group of people leading the way here and laying down the templates for how, you know, everything else will kind of swirl out into the rest of the communities. So the other thing about this time is that we are redesigning our thoughts, beliefs, and patterns, and we are into this polarizing stretch, you know, which is that whole idea of not being able to hold two views, so having to collapse into the middle. So that's what we're doing as a society, being kind of stretched to the extremes, and that's what we're witnessing as well. So, you know, what we've witnessed in Wellington with the police, or with a small group of the police who, you know, followed instructions to do particular behaviours that were very violent and very against the people who they ought to have been serving. And then the same with watching that with the police in Canada, with those bringing in the horses and a couple of people being trampled. You know, that is not how humanity needs to be working together. And so again, that's a big slap in the face, isn't it? That's a big take note kind of thing. So that's what we'll be witnessing, these things that are obviously out of order, that don't belong, and then that will provide momentum for change. So that's what I saw with the police. I thought, right, so that's a system breakdown that we're witnessing there. So then that shows us, okay, things have to change. And so that's what people can witness. So we can see it always from the, you know, we can see it from that point of view of, oh, that was painful to watch, I cried. And from a higher view, I can see that's pointing out to all of us that doesn't work. That doesn't work and that isn't acceptable to us. And so therefore that needs to change. So those things have to be moved out. And what do we do to replace it? What are those things that we still need that to function in? And maybe some of those things don't have any place in our future world. But these are the sorts of thoughts that are being provoked. Right.
Totally. It's often from the contrast that we see what we really do want, isn't it?
Yes, exactly. Yeah, well, I don't want that. Yeah. So what is it that I do?
And again, you look at the template again, and you know, Wellington, and they don't need, you know, anyone telling them what to do there. They're all just, like you say, marae, you know, stepping in and doing what they know needs to be done. So there's no push-pull. It's beautiful.
And you know, it's how whānau operates, isn't it? I come from a big family, and we don't have, oh, you do that and you do that. Just everyone just pitches in and all of a sudden it's done.
Just knows, what to do.
So that's, you know, that's what we're watching demonstrated, really. And I think it's just beautiful. And then we're becoming more crystalline as well. So, you know, we know that, a lot of us know that we're shifting from being carbon-based to becoming into crystalline silica-based, which is the Christed light, or the Christos, or the crystalline liquid light, which is of the Christ consciousness. That's how I see it. And so we're becoming more of that, more in alignment with higher consciousness, which is this notion of working together in harmony and unity and creating unified field. So we're into that place, working also with our higher heart. So that's another aspect of heart change that we've been experiencing in a collective way, and especially the men. So the men in our world have been having this experience of you could see how I feel about it, because it's just, honestly, it just moves me. But they've been having their hearts, you know, like really stretched open, connected to their higher heart, their soul purpose, figuring out why they're here, what they're meant to do. That's one aspect of it. And the second aspect of it is then learning how to speak it. So they're learning how to speak their feelings. So they've been having these throat energetic softenings. So they can feel their heart, know what is their truth, and then speak it out. So that's our men coming into their soft, beautiful hearts. And so this is a big shift for us on a social community way. So we're just going through all this release and the new coming in. So the other thing is that we're really starting to take our roles now. So the feminine in our world, we are really pulling down these higher dimensional frequencies down, so they are closer to our physical plane, and the men are pulling the physical up, so that we're kind of merging this higher dimensional frequencies, dimensions, resonance, principles. We're merging that down and pulling it up so that they come in together, and that's how we form our new world. And then we'll move in and bring in seventh and ninth and 12th and etc. dimensional frequencies and ideas. But this is like the baseline that we're moving through to that. Gaia, this really surprised me. I really did. So I think a long time ago, when I would have spoken to friends about ascension, it was a very moment, you know. It was this idea that there would be something that happened in our world that was instantaneous that would shift things. And some people would be, basically burnt up. What's the word?
Transported.
No, totally like made into ash, like incinerated. Some people would be incinerated, that some people would be transported. Yep. That some people, some people would do other things. Some people would go somewhere else. But we've really been in the softness of ascension now. So we've been going through these mini waves of ascension. Tomorrow is one of those. So tomorrow is we've had some warm-up energies for that. And tomorrow, so how I've been showing this is like a water blasting nozzle fully opened into a ring, so it can cut through things, and that's what we're going to have as an experience tomorrow. Now I don't know how that's going to feel, but it's this idea of this wash, so I guess it's like being under a needle shower, having this wash. So we've been going through lots of purification so that we can hold these higher frequencies, and this is just a I guess another level of that. But it's this is the purification, the releasing the veils, the showing the truth. But that's how I see the energy, as though it sort of cuts through like that. And then she says we're moving into an ascension window, like a planetary ascension window. Yes. And that's going to come. That she talks about a window being, it was interesting because I wrote the dates, and then someone on my Facebook page wrote, oh, that's just the day before Easter, which I didn't know. So I just wrote the dates that Gaia told me. So she said the window opens on the, I hope I've got this correct in my head, the 12th of March, and it closes on the 15th of April. So somewhere in here we're going to have this planetary ascension. And that's this movement, really, this planetary movement. We're moving further again. We've had lots of little incremental polar shifts, like just slightly. We've been moving northeast,
yes,
just marginally, like a degree, 2 degrees, but this is a bit like a trajectory, a movement. Further into the photonic route towards the galactic center. So in that window, and so Gaius always has been speaking to me regarding ascension and regarding change in our world. It's all based on the collective. So it's based on, like how full is the jar. So
yes,
a while ago it was all about individual ascension, but then there was this realization. And I'm just all, you know, it may or may not be true, but this is my perception of my conversations with her over the last 6 years, is that now it was seen that more of us could ascend. And so that's why there's been, you know, it's taken maybe a bit longer on the timeline, but there's more. And Gaia speaks about that being 70% of humanity who can ascend. And although we're having an ascension window, and that's a planetary ascension, and we'll be in fifth dimensional existence at that point. And so we'll have this sort of bandwidth of that, and there'll be people who are, you know, working at higher levels. And I'm not sure exactly what happens to the people who aren't quite at that level at when we go through that. But what Gaia has said is that there's, you know, there's a couple of years for other people to come into that dimensional space. So I imagine it means that we hold a slightly, you know, like a third, fourth dimensional band somewhere gets held here as well.
We're the bridge.
So the window for that, and so we're moving into we're having a fifth dimensional ascension sometime between the middle of next month and the middle of the following month.
I know.
It's exciting, huh?
Yes. I was showing that too, Sharon, and that January was going to be the month where one thing, one after the other, after the other, after the other, like it was a screed of things, were all going to come into the light and be exposed. March, February and March were where we move ourselves in a sense of adjusting to the new, because this information now is old, it's gone, it's outdated, and we're now moving into a new space within ourselves of the truth and what is truth for us in our ascension state. And then by the end of March, April was always shown to me as April. It's just this brilliant light, and there's just this whole new way of like consciousness, you know, that is absolutely like global. For me, it was everyone. It was just amazing. And I'm and the way that Jan, because I was like, oh yeah, you know, we'll see, we'll wait and see what happens. But January proved itself to be exactly what I was showing. So I'm really knowing that by the end of March, we're absolutely in a new space. And, you know, this talk of virus and, you know, all that stuff, all that whole narrative is just gone. And everyone's like, what? Oh, God, that seems like 10 years ago. It's just so out of our consciousness. So it's a beautiful thing.
And I agree.
It's played a role in that, hasn't it? The whole virus thing has played a role.
Oh, gosh, yes, absolutely. I agree that I came into this year too knowing that in April, so the words that were with me is that in April we will not know ourselves. We will be the new version, the latest, newest version of ourselves, and what we do with that will be entirely up to us. So as it always is, of course, but we'll be in a whole new knowing, and still we're learning and still we're growing and evolving. So what we do with this newness will be entirely up to us and part of our journey forward. But we're going to be very, very different in how we feel about ourselves, how we see life, and what we know it all to be. So it's exciting.
It feels
very exciting.
We're moving out of survival.
Yes.
You know? So how we've been controlled and made small is through all of the energies of you must do this to survive.
Yeah.
But now we'll be looking at, well, what do I need to feel good? What do I need to thrive? What
that's it.
What really makes my heart move? And and that will be
survival to thrive.
Exactly. Yeah. And so although the world will still present itself as a learning ground and a darker, heavier at times place to be or playground, we'll be in a whole new layer and level of the knowing of ourself, and it's what we do with that out there is our journey forward. And it won't have the same effect. as it does even now, even with our expanded knowing, like us three, I'm talking about particularly here, and those like us that have a more wide awake view of the world and what's actually going on and why and where our place is within it, it's not going to have anywhere near the same effect on us on a deep level, because we're new, we're different, and our place in this whole narrative, this play, is going to be very different.
Yes, and the collective shadow, as is our own personal shadow,
yeah,
so that is really, well, on one level, it's all of it's on its way out.
Yeah.
And so we know that things happen at different levels, but I made a comment last week to light workers that if you're feeling like you're out of sorts and you don't know why, it's likely that you're feeling the density of the planet moving through your field on its way out.
So it's so much
lighter, you know, what we're in the midst of now is already
much
lighter.
Yes.
Yeah. And we see the dissolving. Go on, Mandy.
Sorry. Tangibly, you know, even just like looking out there now, the light seems brighter even in its own form here. It's like, you know, it's sometimes I have to really, like, I find putting my hand over my third eye actually helps me to focus in the light here. But the other thing too is that we have been learning that we have all collectively, unconsciously, by default, really, creating en masse what we've all been experiencing now. This is what we've been doing over lifetimes. We've all done this. Now what I see is people, and this is the bit that I love, is that they're consciously coming together, realizing that, hang on a minute, we are all consciously together. And we now, where I see April going, is that we're now coming together in that conscious awareness that we're creating together. Before, it was all about manifesting for us. What do we need right now? Oh, I need a new car or whatever it might be. Now we're coming into the bigger picture and realizing that we're collectively creating this together. And that's what I'm seeing in Wellington. They've clicked to that. They've got that click going, that this is what we can create. We can create it even bigger and wider and globally if we want to. So that's the part that I think is really exciting, is that they've realized they're conscious creators together.
Yes.
Mm.
Yes. And the power of that, you know, so we're consciously uncreating, undoing.
Yes.
You know, it's that you're a drip, I'm a drip, and you're a drip. And, and you know, each of us, whatever we contain within that, it's that holographic nature.
Yeah.
So that becomes the whole. And, you know, this we'll learn. Gaia speaks about using water for this as manifestation, as though, you know, we put the energy, the essence, the thought, the program into the water, and then release the water back to the water.
Yeah.
And the water has its own cycle, so it actually goes through everything.
Yeah.
So it moves from the, you know, from in its water cycle, from the clouds to the top of the mountain, through the rivers, into the ocean, and back up into the clouds, but releases the rain. And then as it releases the rain, that comes into all of our food and into our water that we put in our bodies. And so it comes through us and all the animals and all of nature. So, you know, we will learn to use the holographic aspect of nature to also bring about co-creation. And these children that are here now, and many of them feeling probably not so much now, but recently lost, unsure about what the world is about, the world being very energetically challenging. You know, they've come here with great purpose, and, you know, that will begin to arise for them as to why they're here and what they're to do. And they'll be bringing inventions and thoughts and ways of being to our world. And, you know, so I mean, I laughed at this whole notion about school, because, you know, education's been my passion for a lot of my life. And of course, it's become out of sync with the people it serves. And so here we are, watching parents wanting to homeschool their kids because of governmental intrusion into what they ought to do or not do. And the, like, one of my personal concerns on a bigger level in our world is the sexualization aspect that's come in really strongly in the last 2 years, and it's been very insidious in my view. And so I just you know, we need to be mindful of that. That's been another intrusion, another inversion, and so we have to be careful to not be in judgment of people for whom that feels, you know, biologically, intrinsically right. But it's the, it's, and this is the cleverness of the intrusion, right, is that it creates something bigger than what it really is. And then you have to step carefully and gently, because there are individuals for that, for whom that is true. So we just need to be aware of that, and the sexualization that's come into our health curriculum here in New Zealand, there are some big questions around that that need to be asked and answered. So, you know, these are all the things that we will navigate, but we'll just do it with wisdom and from our heart.
Organically.
And kids will say, oh, well, I don't want to know that, or I don't want to do that. And, you know, so all of that will happen as well as they come into their own voice. Let me see what I've got here about April. My glasses all steamed up. So we're moving into this developing emotional sustenance, which is a nice frame, isn't it? Beginning to have experiences of unconditional love, seeking a more spiritual countenance, and forming greater relationships with our inner self and higher self as this ascension window opens for our fifth dimensional world. And then in April, she said solid foundations will begin to be exemplified, tweaked, and embedded, and new philosophies will begin to be set up. Principles of coexistence for thriving, for the good of all, a greater exploration of who each of us is as an individual and how we contribute to the whole, and how that contributes to the collective. So she's speaking about that. So that's quite interesting, isn't it? So that's almost this idea that will be the ingredients of the cake are put in the bowl, and we're mixing it up to see, you know, what will we do with it? Will we make little cakes, or a slice, or a big tower? And so we'll be playing with some of these, I think that's it, really. We'll be exploring some of these new ways of being with one another in community.
Isn't that exciting?
It is, isn't it?
Yeah.
And so she
says
higher principles are more fluid than what we're used to in our 3D world. They're inclusive of similarities and differences, based on love and good for all, and that, oh yeah, that's what I just said here. We will explore these in an experiential sense as humanity, rather than as a set of guidelines passed down from one generation.
So it's going
beautiful.
Very interesting.
Just incredible.
I love it. I love the way that we're all in sync with each other too. Our messages are all in alignment. Even if the language is slightly different at times, the meaning is clear and pure and right there.
And it's so affirming, isn't it?
Yeah.
It is.
We thought we came to the world for this.
We did. It's been such a wonderful journey, though. I you know, wouldn't change it. Moments I might have wanted to, but in the bigger picture and the, you know, the journey itself, it's been amazing, and it still is. And there's a lot more excitement happening now. I think we've got through the shock of, you know, the way it was presented to us in this shift. But now it's exciting to see where it's going and what's coming up, you know, in the creative new. It's wonderful.
Yeah.
So in a way, it's like we are at a phase where we're cleaning house, ready to move.
Yes.
Totally.
Keep this or not. Oh, we might use that. I might remodel that, or I might, you know, recover that. Or
This
has to go. This has had its day, and we'll be doing that with all of our systems and structures, and they'll just take on new light, and they'll take on new frequency, and there'll be much more. I see collaboration. So when I've looked at, and I had this little zip into the future quite a long time ago, and I saw that, you know, our government becomes one level. So it, you know, I think that when people are speaking about having new governance, or, you know, a new government, that that's old paradigm.
Agree.
It's not going to happen.
No. Ways of governance, and that, and I saw children on that. Elderly, you know, I saw it was a council of elders, but it didn't mean they were all elderly. And
council of wisdom.
So I think we're pretty close to that happening around the world, and where, you know, we will have to learn greater trust with one another.
As we
move along, that'll get easier, won't it? When we know that because this is a really massive thing that's going to happen. So when Gaia told me this, I just burst out laughing, and you two will understand it because you'll have this experience already. But she said we're going to get to a point where nobody will lie. And they won't lie because of this, because we already know this, we feel the energy of a lie. So we know when something is truth and something is a lie. In general, maybe we're not 100% of it, but, you know, we know.
Yeah.
And so everybody will develop that skill. Everyone will become adept at that. And so then the people who tell lies will realize there is no point to telling them anymore.
No traction. Exposure straight away. Yep.
As there's no traction to be gained, they'll cease, and then no one will tell lies. And isn't that going to be a different world to be in?
So, so for me, the message came through that we will all be transparent to each other. So in that transparency and all being seen, right now we are learning to be able to be transparent because to be able to move through in the pure vibration. Transparency is part of that. So here we are.
We learn to speak our truth
to ourselves. Yeah, exactly.
And then we'll speak our truth to others, and then all of this will move through. So you can, for me, it's just been very interesting to watch these shifts occur, knowing they were coming, and then seeing them kind of pop up in different places.
Yeah.
Watching how they're going to, you know, merge and move out across the world. But, you know, these foundational principles that we like to believe that we operate in, that are kind of sitting on a faulty foundation. These things will change. And so that's what Gaia said, when everybody is provided with their basic need, which is our right as of being a being on the planet, human or animal, or plant, any being on the planet, it's their right to be, you know, fed and nurtured and warm, and have their needs provided. So when you have that, the lack goes. So therefore greed goes. So therefore hoarding goes. You know, I've got three of these. You know, that is why I've become a prepper, not because I don't need very much, but I have thought, well, I can, you know, other people won't do that, so I can.
That's right.
Things like that. And so this is the place that we'll move into. I've got two of them. I only need one because I know when I need another, it will be here. So we'll be in that. Come into flow with abundance of provision, and then greed will go and selfishness will go. And then when greed and selfishness go, along with everyone speaking truth, I mean, just those simple principles being is going to have huge ramifications across our civilization.
Absolutely, yeah. What a fabulous
Bring it on.
Yes, what a fabulous world we're moving into. Well, it's a fabulous world right now, and more and more and more moments. So,
yeah. So each of us who's here now, you know, we're blessed to be here because it's a very exciting thing in the history of the omniverse for us to be present with.
Yes.
Yeah.
Woo-hoo. Such a wonderful conversation, Sharon. Thank you so, so much.
Yeah.
Pleasure to be here. Oh. And see, hasn't time gone so quickly?
Yeah, hasn't it? Isn't that incredible? We'll have to get you back in a few months and do it again.
Yes, we will.
Well, it's so easy for us to have conversation, isn't it?
Yes. Yeah, it is. It's wonderful.
We're all on the same page. Yeah. Thank you for being here, Sharon.
Oh, it's been my absolute pleasure. Thank you so much for inviting me. It's so really wonderful to sit in this space with you both.
Oh, gorgeous. Well, we will get you on again, that is for sure.
All right. Well, enjoy this beautiful day.
Those it is a beautiful aren't day.
In New Zealand, we're enjoying rather magical weather on and off.
Sure. Wonderful. Thank you.
Thank you.
Lots of love.
Love to you.